hello, you malty medabblers, and thank you to Just Another Day, 333, 333, for that malt mention. Definitely an online name, absolutely. And talking about online, that's exactly where we are at the moment, sharing, you and I, another quality moment in cyberspace. Yes, this virtual reality in which stuff happens. And it just so happens the stuff that's happening at this moment in time is a whisky review. Good start. And it is part of a series here in Whisky Review 283 of old vintage whiskies, single malts specifically. And I started by introducing the three whiskies I was going to be reviewing in Whisky Review 282. And one vlog on, here we are, the bottle, pouring some, talking about it. Brilliant. Expensive stuff, old whiskey. When I say old, I mean 20, 25 years plus. It was many years ago that Jim McEwen at Bruichladdie happened to mention that in a passing conversation that whiskey generally comes into full maturity between 17 and 23 years, because that age is where a good cask with good spirit in traditional maturation will reach the place where the spirit and the cask are balancing and becoming more than the sum of the parts. Now, when you get past that stage, past that 23 or 25, you're getting into these old vintage whiskies, and many of them are dominated by the cask. So it might be a very nice whisky, but you're not really getting much of the spirit anymore. There's some whiskies, in fact, that you basically 30, 40, even 50 years old, that essentially you're tasting rather oaky, woody, tannic, sherryish usually, spirit that doesn't really have much of a whiskiness to it. You've got to be careful, oh so careful, with the cost of vintage and old whiskies about what you go for. And of course the best place to find out is online, by going to the trusty reviewers and bloggers and vloggers and all the rest of it, who are coming from different perspectives and giving different opinions. And when you tie up with several opinions and they coincide, or they give you a fuller picture, then you know when it's safer to be spending your money on the right stuff rather than taking the risk of spending your money on the wrong stuff. Let me help. Lochside, Berry Brothers and Rudd, purveyors of provenance and provender to posh people in London. The thing about Berry Brothers is that they're one of the oldest wine houses in England, and as such they have some very well established links and connections going back generations to the Scotch whisky industry, and it tends to show in the calibre of what they're bottling. They don't get it right every time, but I do find Berry Brothers bottlings, there's some absolute sparkling gems to be found. Yeah, with old whiskies like this Lochside, it's 30 years old, by the way. It was distilled in 1981. It's a dead distillery. It's dead because in 1992 it shut down completely and will never produce again. Now, the difference between, before I start reviewing this, the difference between a dead distillery and a mothballed distillery, there's a significant difference. A mothballed distillery is one where they've ceased production, but everything is in place that production can be resumed. It may cost a bit of money to repair the buildings, or perhaps to even install new stills, but essentially, if there is a desire and investment, then a distillery could be up and running again. A good example of that is Glenlochie. But Lochside, no, it's the, many of the distillery buildings are now bulldozed, and it will never produce again, simple as that. So this is a dead distillery. And when you initially put your nose into the glass, if you're not greatly experienced with whiskey, it can be a little bit confusing. You're saying to yourself, well, it smells nice, but smells a bit weird as well. Now, helpful hint, get yourself a bottle of standard whiskey, not peated, not heavily peated. And before you have a nose and a sip of your expensive old vintage whiskey, take a decent standard blend or malt and get started with that. What happens is you're familiarizing your smell and your taste with a whiskey point of reference. And it means that when you move on to the old expensive whiskey, your nose has got its bearings and so has your taste. This is bottled at 46%. It comes from cask 777, which I think in this instance means virtually nothing. What I would say from smelling and tasting this Lochside, my impression is that it's been a sherry butt, possibly a refill sherry butt, because with a fresh fill sherry going many, many years in storage, the dominance of the sherry becomes a big factor, drowning and flooding out the flavour of the spirit. Whereas with this Lochside, I've been struck immediately about how intact the actual signature is of the spirit itself. Now, again, even for someone in my position as a commentator, I don't come across Lochsides that often. But I'm immediately getting, and I'll come to my tasting notes now. On the nose, warm, gingery and spicy malt. Wonderful to discover that the spirit itself, the signature and the character, so wonderfully intact. I'm getting raisins, I'm getting a touch of peat, spicy malt, lemongrass, vanilla, jasmine tea, corn, green pea and pineapple cubes. When you're adding water to old whiskies, very simple advice, start by not adding any water at all. Even where a vintage or old aged whiskey is at a relatively high strength in the bottle, don't let that fool you. It can actually be remarkably delicate in the palate because flavour does lose its vitality and intensity over time. That can happen and frequently does, even as it takes on the additional complexity of ageing in the cask over a prolonged period of time. The notable whiskies, malts, and particularly malts we're talking about, that really can go the distance are the likes of Macallan, Springbank, Strathyla, Longmorn, Glen Grant, great example. And particularly amongst the independent bottlers, Glen Grant is old Glen Grants are well worth looking out for. Slightly salty on the nose, solventy, Airfix glue, very, very soft. And there's a certain syrupy yeastiness as well. The taste is I will add a drop of water, but very, very little. Very little. 2-3 drops, no more. You'll find, particularly at whiskey festivals, that because you've got a, a tremendous variety and choice of whiskies that you want to go around and try them all. And if one of the independent bottlers at a whiskey festival has old whiskies, it's very tempting to get a little taste and then have finished it within 10-15 minutes, because you've only got about 3 or 4 or 5 hours at the most at a whiskey event. And you're really missing out there, because old whiskies, you really need to take your time in drinking them. In fact, just make it last an hour or more, because you're getting the full conversation with these old whiskies, and it does need time. Taste wise, bittersweet, intensely bittersweet, surprisingly so. Incredible freshness going on here. Slight gluey note, but nothing off-putting. Interestingly, when you examine the location of Lochside, it's East Coast Scotland. It's a Highland, or was a Highland distillery, sandwiched between Dundee and Aberdeen, just beside Montrose. Fascinating medieval town. And fed from the River Esk. There's three other distilleries around, only one of which is still operating, and that's Glencadam. But the other two are closed, as well as Lochside. But and amazingly, I'm getting references of Old Pulteney here. I think it's in the kind of the slightly overripe fruit and saltiness. And I'm also getting the aromatic nature of Glengarry, which in fact is not that far up the road from this distillery. So what's fascinating about this whiskey, one of the fascinating points, is that when I'm tasting it, I'm getting these references to a strong regional style, which you see in readily available malts like Pulteney and Glengarry. Taste, bittersweet, fruit sour malt and glucose notes, set in sweetness, complex, tea, vanilla, pineapple cubes, lemongrass, tropical notes of guava and papaya and cologne, eau de cologne. Over time, and when I'm saying over time, I mean I've had this whiskey in a glass for about an hour, and eventually you get hints, weirdly, of Kentucky whiskey. I'm thinking Heaven Hill here. Fennel and bitter tea. Interestingly, the bitterness, it's not so much bitter oak. I think there's been a bitterness in the spirit itself. This is one of these old school malts that doesn't take prisoners. If you like intense flavoured malts like Lafroy and Talisker, I think you'll enjoy this a lot. If you like the lighter, sweeter ones, which are tend to be what's called now accessible, keyword in marketing, accessibility, you might be a little bit off-put by this. And that's why I do recommend that even if you were to buy bottles like Lochside from dead distilleries, just while they're still available, and not even open them until you feel you've got enough whiskey experience behind you that you're going to be able to open them in a few years' time, 2 years, 5 years, 10, 20 years. Never be afraid to keep a whiskey for drinking. It will last just fine in the bottle, so long as it's full and sealed and stored upright, so as that you're not soaking the cork. The cork in a bottle of whiskey is different from the cork in a bottle of wine. They are different consistency, same material, different density, different purpose. The cork in a bottle of Scotch whiskey is designed to be put in and out, in and out, in and out. The cork in a bottle of wine is designed to be removed once and once only. Therefore, the cork in a standard bottle of malt is of a softer variety. Therefore, you do not store the whiskey on its side, or you will soak the lighter cork and it will deteriorate. It will also lead to leakage, whether physical leakage or spirit evaporating through the cork and the seal. So always store your whiskey upright in a cool environment without too much fluctuation in temperatures. There you go. Now, let's get back to these tasting notes. Finish, papaya and pineapple tea. There's some smokiness in vanilla. And over time, after 20 minutes, I note that this evolves more of a nutty pastry feel to it. After 40 minutes, it turns more fruity and aromatic. And after 1 hour, it becomes more yeasty with a savoury smoke feature about it. And that's one of the things about these old aged whiskies, is that if you're patient in giving them time, you'll see the flavours change and evolve in the glass as all these years and years of storage, which have meant a gradual layering like sediment of flavour building up and locking into the alcohol over that long, long period of time, they've start to slowly undo themselves and come out the glass, up your nose, onto your tongue, and all there for your enjoyment. What mark are we going to give this little beauty? Right. As I've mentioned, it's not over-oaked by any means. The real spirity nature's still in there, so mercifully we've got what has been a reasonable refill, second or even third refill cask for maturing this. 89 out of 100. It's a taste of history. One of the beauties of spirits of alcohol at a particular strength is it will hold something really more or less indefinitely. Not forever, but certainly for our lifetimes, it is perfectly acceptable to be drinking spirits which were produced 100 years ago. They will not actually do you any physical harm. Alcohol is a tremendous disinfectant. It's a solvent. It's a malt mark, by the way. It's been a bit of a rambling review, this, but it's just the way it's evolved, malt mates, and I really just want to kind of get my experience with this old stuff, and hopefully it'll give you better advice and a better point of reference for you to decide, are you going to put down the extra money required to invest in a bottle of this? Easier to do if you're a whiskey club, because people can chip in. But I would finish this vlog on a point of caution, and that is, do your homework first. There are old bottles of whiskey out there which are simply not nice. They're disappointing, and I don't want you to get your fingers burnt. Ouch! You probably noticed something else that's very useful when you're tasting your vintage old whiskies is this is the Malt Maniacs Interactive Malt Map of Scotland. You'll find it at Whisky Fun and Malt Maniacs site. It's a tremendous resource because basically you've got a map of Scotland and you can move it around to where the distilleries are. And if you press, let's make sure this is the right one. Yep. If you press in the distillery, right, you can press the button and then it gives you all sorts of historical facts and information about a particular distillery. Here it is, Hillside, tells you when it was founded, about the coffee stills and about the major fire that affected the distillery. It gives you a potted history, and it's a very useful thing to kind of read up on this, so that when you are tasting your whiskey, you're getting just more information and more appreciation of just what's happening in the glass. And there you have it, all done and dusted. There we are. Another vlog in the bag, and I'm Ralphie. Hope you've enjoyed this. If you come back in a few more days, yeah, you will notice Whisky Review 284, in which I will be reviewing a Speyside dead distillery called Colburn. Right, see you then.